Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel. I'm Alex Petrescu, and today we are going to talk about two topics. The first one would be a teaser or a short presentation of my latest course, the Balanced Scorecard. The course is available already on Udemy and Patreon. Remember, should you want to buy only one course or several, you can do that through Udemy. On the other hand, if you wish to have access to all my courses, the ones that I released so far, and if you keep the subscription, you can have a monthly subscription and gain access also to the courses that I will release in the future. You have links for Patreon and Udemy below this video for both of them. And the second topic we are going to talk about today is a follow-up of what we have already spoken last week, the part two of the savings and investment commentary, discussion, presentation, rant, name it as you want. But before we start with these two main topics of for the today presentation, I have already told you last week that I have been looking for opportunities to help you as viewers of this Finance and Accounting Education channel on one hand, and on the other hand to help me also finance this this channel on YouTube. You have some links also below this video. I have already presented to you the opportunities from Amazon. One of them is with the audiobooks or the Audibles. You can get two Audibles for free. If you are into audiobooks or if you just want to try them, but as an alternative, if you just read normal books and you want to enroll in the Kindle program, you also have a link below. And of course, the third option that I have already presented to you is just to help me with my wish list on Amazon. On this wish list, there are several items which can help me improve the quality of my videos. You can find there a better webcam, a green screen, helping me to have a nicer background for my videos, light system in case the light in my apartment is not always very good for filming these videos, a mobility solution, a laptop in case I will resume my travel and to keep up with doing these videos on a regular basis, even if I am no longer here in Vienna. Some software for editing, so licensed latest version of Microsoft Office, some software for video editing, the better version than I already have, and all sorts of products in this area that can help me improve the quality of my videos and would also be very beneficial for you, not only for myself. But the novelty of this week, and it took a little bit more than with the other ones, I have also a link for you to, you might have already noticed in several advertisements over YouTube or on any other channels, I have a link to join the eToro community for you. Long story short, it's complementing very well my presentation about the investments. You can buy shares there, but not only, there are also other instruments, of course. The advantage is, so compared to, let's say, your bank account, if you have a bank which is offering you this opportunity of buying shares, of investing in the stock market or in bonds or in whatever you want to invest, per my list of potential destinations for your wealth investing, eToro is a very good solution because they don't charge any commission or fee for your transaction, especially if you plan on doing regular transactions or more often than once every several years. And even if you buy some shares one time or two times, it's always worth saving the money you would otherwise pay to a regular bank for managing your investments, so your financial assets. Now coming back to the two points that I have already mentioned, we talk about a balanced scorecard, the approach or the summary of the topics that are captured in this presentation, in this course. We start with the criticism of using an approach of financial numbers only. In many companies, there is only financial information. It's available in all the companies, financial information, especially the statutory and the legal one, due to legal requirements. You might already know many authorities, regulators that ask for such information. Based on several standards, maybe you have a local gap or an international, so IFRS, International Financial Reporting Standard, or some specific norms and so on and so forth. Sometimes you might have also performance management numbers or management accounting numbers for decision making within the company. But using only that is not a very good idea. I'm explaining in this point why is it so and how should you try to complement the information from from finance and accounting, from this dimension. Then we are going to talk about vision and strategy, about critical success factors. Those are two prerequisites, or so two steps which need to be taken in order. So before we start building our balanced scorecard, they are absolutely necessary. Without them, you cannot do it. Or you can do something which will look like a balanced scorecard, but it will not work very well, and or potentially it will not work at all. Then we talk about the KPIs, and I have said that the financial numbers are like 25%. That means that there must be some other three dimensions. So in total, there will be four dimensions. Then we talk about whether we should have a top-down, bottom-up approach when building this tool. So it's not only about or necessarily about the way we are using it on a regular as a regular reporting tool, but when we decide what to put inside it just at the beginning, or with the when we revise it and we decide to improve it, to enhance it, to change it, what kind of approach do we take. You might know top to down approaches from the top of the company, so from the CEO level, from the board level, dictating what should be done, or from the bottom up, so going from the regular employees, or at least from the entry level managers, and suggesting what should be done. You might have already known which is the preferred approach, or whether we use both of them or something like that, since we started at the second point with vision and strategy. But I will get into more details in the course. I said there are four dimensions. Well, it's very easy. One of them is the customer, so the customer perspective or the customer dimension. Then we are going to talk about learning and growth or development direction, which has much to do with the HR component of the company, with the personnel, with learning, it's saying the training and nurturing the know-how in the company. And then we are going to talk about internal business processes. This fits very much the definition of the supply chain which you have in your company, the way that the company acquires its let's say needed raw materials and services, how is changing them, how is the company adding value, how is passing them forward to the sales, through the sales to the customers. So we are going to look in this direction. And of course, last but not least, we are going to talk about the financial dimension. It's still 25%. It's important. And at the end, we will have some examples with three critical success factors, and looking at that I have selected. I have left the financials empty, so we talk more only about customers, learning and development, and internal business processes. The financials, I have left it empty. There is also a homework should you want to do the financials dimension, especially if you are from performance management, so from FP&A. If you want to tackle one of the other three dimensions, you can also do it in this homework. The idea would be to either rely on the critical success factors that I have defined in my course, or to come up with new ones, which can be also only theoretical, or they can come up from your company, from your organization where you work right now. It's up to you. And as I'm saying also in the course, I will look into the way you are linking these critical success factors and deriving objectives and KPIs that align somehow with this, and if this can work. I mean, if the things are rounded and structured and they make sense from my point of view. Now, if we are done with the balanced scorecard, the balanced scorecard is a very nice tool. Usually it's driven by performance management, so in FP&A, but it might be that somebody else, there might be a management office, let's say in the company, that it's trying to build such a tool from scratch, and then looking at regular delivery. Anybody who's interested in how the balanced scorecard works or wants to build one should benefit a lot from these points that I have in this, because this course also has a lot of experience behind it. So what happened in the past in my career and how I did it. And I think that's the real value added behind. And I'm talking not only about let's say the hard skills or the technical competencies that you need for such a tool, but also having a mild approach to the soft skills, so how to communicate, how to get people on board, and how should things work from let's say human perspective, or as I have said several times before as well, how do you convince the other kids to play with you? Now, if we are done with the balanced scorecard presentation, let's take a look at our saving and investing part two. I'm saying here paying for the middleman. Why? Because we talked already in the first part about current and deposit accounts in a bank. We are going to talk about investment funds and hedge funds as well. With this second part, and we are going to see what's about this middleman. The idea is, okay, I have, if you remember from the first installment of this commentary, I have listed several options in no particular order. Maybe there is a particular order, but it's not that obvious. I said we are going to talk about investment funds, pension funds, insurance funds, shares, bonds, real estate, FX and resources, and that we are not going to talk about cryptocurrencies. Today we are going to focus ourselves on the first point, so the investment funds. What are the investment funds? It's quite simple. They are companies, or behind them there is a company that is administering these investment funds. You give them your money, your wealth, your the amount you want to invest, and they pull this money from several customers, and they invest it further in various financial assets and with various strategies. Of course, they have different risk profiles. Some are less risky. They are more, let's say, money market oriented. They will invest more in bonds, government bonds, or AAA bonds, or they might keep also some bank deposits and so on and so forth. This will also provide you with a lower return on investment, as the ones which will take the high risk, which will go more in the direction of shares. Usually they stick to the official stock exchanges, or to the blue chips, the so-called blue chips, the large companies, the important ones, the ones that are well known. But you might find some opportunities where they go for like business angels investing in startups and things like this. The idea is that they pulled a lot of money from the investors, and they reduce the risk through diversification. So they look in various industries, various regions, several instruments and so on and so forth. However, they bring moderate returns, usually a little bit better than the regular bank deposits and current accounts, but not extraordinary, so don't have extraordinary expectations from the investment funds. Paying the middleman, you need to understand between you and the financial assets that the investment funds are buying, you also have a structure with employees, with investment fund managers that need to receive salary. Sometimes they also want some very large bonuses, which are worth or not. So they have earned those bonuses or not most of the time, and they think they need to be paid somehow. And they are, since they are, have this, some of them have, or they have some risk profile that is somewhere between moderately low to moderately high. They are better than just throwing yourself buying directly financial assets. If you are a beginner, I bought my first investment funds when I was in high school. I had a little bit of money, so not that much, and I have invested in investment funds. I had some money from the scholarships and I don't know what else. It was then when I was also the victim of a Ponzi scheme for the first and last time so far, and I hope it will be the last time. It was a public investment fund which should have been regulated, was on TV, everybody was taking their money there. The returns were outstanding. I don't remember because it's such a long time since then. I was putting money in, taking it out, buying various stuff, then putting some more money in, then taking it out, buying whatever I needed. And my last goal was to buy a stereo, and I didn't pull the money out before it crashed. I have no idea in the end if because I didn't do the math, or I don't remember doing it, or the result of it, if I really lost money or because of this putting money in, taking it out, maybe it was on neutral side, or I have might have even on the overall made a small gain. Now, from my point of view, you can classify them from, we already talked about the risk profile, but there are two types. Some of them are not listed, they are not listed on the stock exchange. You need to take care of the reputation, so who's behind them, which banks are depositing the funds, or which banks are administering the, or which companies, or these kind of things. You need to look in the past, how many years, what kind of they have been around, what kind of performance they have. But you need to be aware that past performance is absolutely no guarantee. You can still lose your money. The fact that an investor was serious, or the head of the investment funds was serious for 5 years, doesn't guarantee that he's not going to run away with your money. Remember, we will talk also about hedge funds. Bernie Madoff, one of the people that has stolen the most money from the financial systems in years. So one of the most well-known Ponzi scheme administrator was having a hedge fund, so a different type of investment fund. We will also come to the hedge funds. I'm saying here that some Ponzi schemes have been hidden behind this. A Ponzi scheme is very simple. It's not doing that much. It's just paying the first investors based on the money that the later investors are bringing in the scheme, and it works. It cannot work too long, because first they are paying very high returns to the first investors. So they need always to expand the base, so the more and more people need to come into the system so that it's still sustainable on a longer period, and at some point they run out of new customers and everything crashes. the clear advantage of personally, I prefer them much more than the other ones on the listed, is that you have the asset base, so what the investment fund has bought with your money, and usually weekly. I haven't seen daily or any other systems. They are giving you a price for your for your units, the units that you are holding. So let's say you've bought 100 units worth $1 or €1, so you have invested $100, and they will tell you the next week if your unit is no longer worth $1 but $1.20 or something like that. So there is a clear link between the performance of how they are investing and what you see as the price of your investment or your current wealth, and based on this you can buy more of them or you can sell funds units. And from my point of view, it's clear, there is no doubt. Of course, if they are not tricking you and they are not a Ponzi scheme, with which occasion they will show you next week that your unit is worth no longer $1 but it's worth $5, and that should be an alarm bell for you that something is not okay. So this direct link between the assets, the investments of the investment fund, and your wealth, that what you see in your account, this is what I like more about this not listed investment funds. Of course, contrary to the listed ones, they have they are less, let's say, less regulated, less overseen, less checked, and they might have not that much of a reputation, let's say. Then we have the listed ones. Some of them are also called this ETF. Also, if you are looking at the indexes, so some of the New York Stock Exchange or the London Stock Exchange, the idea is that the fund itself has a price on a stock exchange. I'm seeing here that so it's like you own shares in a company that owns shares or other types of investments. I'm saying that they are less riskier than the non-listed one, because they are listed and they are subject to more regulation and scrutiny than the other ones. Potentially they might have a better reputation and history. The problem that I have is that the prices of these ETFs on the stock exchange is somehow not very much directly linked with the asset base that they have under administration. So they might be doing very good investments, bringing in the fund a lot of dividends, growth of base assets, and so on and so forth. But if somehow the investors don't like or they don't know or whatever in this direction, you might see zero or negative returns in the same time. But this is the problem that you can also have with the company, that the prices of the shares is not always, it's also based on expectations, on market hypes. It's not always directly related to what the company is doing. So for example, you can have a company like Tesla, which has very poor results, but the shares are very expensive because of the market hype. What I have said is that if I would have under administration a hedge fund, I would be looking very much into this listed investment funds, because my personal feeling is that some of them are very poorly managed, that and just like a regular company, when the market capitalization is below the value of the assets that they hold, it's worth taking the control of such investment funds. And of course, it depends what kind of paperwork stays behind them, so what are the rules behind them. But if you can take over such investment funds and just decide to break them up and to sell the assets that they have, you might make a lot of money if they are as I have said, the market valuation, so the market capitalization is far less than the value of the assets they are administering. Somehow they do a good job technically, but they don't manage to convince the investors to really buy the units that they put on the stock exchange. Then what are the hedge funds? So those you talked about investment funds. Investment funds are for everybody, more or less, that has money. Minimum amounts. Hedge funds are a playground for rich people. I said here, so only the rich people have access to this. They take far more risk than a regular investment fund, or they should, because they also promise higher returns. But you cannot really enter into a hedge fund unless you are already rich. They have minimum investment requirements, so you need to, I'm saying here, like at least $250 or $500, it depends. They choose that entry barrier. They also look at your net worth, so how much you already have, and for example, they will not take more than half of your net worth or something in this direction. And they will also look at your yearly income, so how much you are making, and if this investment that you want to put with them or your net worth are somehow is somehow disconnected to how much you are making, they will also not accept you inside. There are, of course, as I have said, each and every one of them has its own rules. They are not accessible to regular guys like you, most of you, and like me. The investment funds also want to deliver good gains, but the purpose of these hedge funds is to beat, and as much as possible beat them by a lot, the indexes. So if the entire New York Stock Exchange is growing, let's say, or the Nasdaq or the London Stock Exchange, they are growing in 1 year with 10%, they would want these such hedge funds, they would want 20%, 30% growth rates or something like that, which is achieved through this kind of margin trading, sophisticated instruments, and how they make also the administrators of such hedge funds, because they make a lot of money for their investors, they also make a lot of money from their sales. You usually need to pay a portion of the gains, so that somehow motivating them to deliver you gains, but you also need to pay a portion of your initial investment, which might, it's somehow securing the hedge funds manager's position, so their gains, but it's not very interesting for you. But they work more or less the same like investment funds. You need to know who is that person who's doing who has the hedge funds and the hedge fund under administration, what kind of returns he delivered in the past, since how many years is he around, if he's since a long time around, maybe he's doing a good job. But you might also, just as I have said, Bernie Madoff has tricked for so many years his investors, you might always have surprises. So don't be sure that possible losses are all also possible. I have said that I will somehow start rating these alternatives. I'm splitting them when there is the case. For example, I have split here the bank current accounts and the bank deposits. I'm giving them stars in a 5-star system. So let's say that the bank current accounts has a very low risk, so 1 out of 5 stars. Liquidity, of course, I gave them 5 stars. It's a current account, you can take your money out. You sometimes have a card, or you can go to the bank and pull your money out. It's very easy. But the rewards are also, we already spoke in the previous presentation, the rewards are also very low. Then you have the bank deposits. The difference is that the liquidity is less. I was tended to give, the risks are similar with the current accounts. They might even have less of a risk than, marginally less of a risk than the current accounts, if there are some jurisdictions in which the states, so the government is there is an insurance or a guarantee fund behind this, and if you lose up to a certain amount, you get your money back from as a poor customer of a bank. Your deposit is somehow guaranteed by the state or by this insurance system. They are of course less liquid. You need to, if you have a deposit for 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, and so on and so forth, or several years, so the liquidity is somehow reduced. I gave them a 3 out of 5. You can still break the deposit, you won't get that much of a reward. And the rewards, it was very difficult. I wanted to say maybe 1.5 stars, because marginally the interest rate is a little bit better than the current account, but it's still so bad that I decided in the end to give it 1 star. So it's still not satisfactory. Then we already talked about investment funds, so it's not about hedge funds, investment funds. So I have somehow merged them. I didn't do this differentiation based on risk profile, based on whether they are listed or not listed, and so on and so forth. What I have said that it's, of course, they take a little bit more risk than even the ones which are in the monetary, so more in the safe zone, in the in the money markets oriented. So they take a little bit more risk than the banks. You take a little bit more risk than with having a bank account, current or deposit. Liquidity, they are also pretty liquid. You either sell them on the stock exchange and you get your money, or you can go to their office and if they are not listed and withdraw your money. So they are pretty liquid, maybe somewhere between current account and deposits. So they got 4 stars out of 5, and the rewards are a little bit better. So they took, I gave them 2 stars out of 5. Compared with the bank current accounts and deposits. With the next installments of this presentation, we will also talk about pension funds, insurance funds, classic and unit linked. This is also a differentiation which I wanted to do here about shares and bonds, real estate, currencies and resources, and you will see what kind of profile you get, how much risk, how is the liquidity. For many people it's very important to have access very fast to their money. For some it's not that important. And the rewards associated with the risk. Usually the higher the risk, the higher the rewards. And for today I think we are done with the second part of this presentation about saving and investments. Please do not forget to like this video if you like it, to share it if you think somebody would be interested about it, to comment should you have any comments about it. I look forward to answering your questions or debating the topics that I'm presenting here, and most important, to subscribe to my channel. That is also supporting it. If you subscribe to it, that means you like it and it's encouraging me to keep going forward. And also don't forget about all the links that are below. Should you want to see the balance, or to buy the balance scorecard course, you can do it through Demi and Patreon. The two offers from Amazon, the two free audiobooks for the Audibles, and the subscription to Kindle. There is also my wish list below, should you want to support me directly with acquiring products that can improve my videos. And also the latest edition, the eToro, where you can buy shares. We haven't spoken about shares. We will speak at some later stage. Without a commission, so there are no fees, which is great. The more you trade, the more fees or commissions you should pay. Even if you don't trade that much, so you are more in the storing business, not in the moving business, let's say, you might know already from which movie character I'm quoting. We will talk at some point about this movie character as well. No matter how often you trade, once per year, once every several years, or once daily, so very often, it's worth not paying this commission, which usually the regular banks are charging you. Once again, I'm Alex Petrescu, and thank you very much for listening to me.